Thus, we have Krishna, R. Krishnan. He's having around 4 years of experience. She's engineering as a graduation and also done a master's in banking technology. From certification perspective, she has ITIL certified, CEH and CSSP. And right now, she's working with Kotak Mahindra Bank as IT audit department. Welcome, Krishna, on the CyberFrat online training.
Thank you, Gaurav. Thank you so much.
So, Krishna, yeah, so just like, you know, you see we have 150, 156 participants today. So, most of all of them are, you know, CSSP aspirants and they want to go for exam. So,
great, so, nice.
We just want to understand, like, you know, you have just done, I think I saw your certificate for on 1st June, you have got it.
Your
hands, right? How was your experience? What all you did and what all, first thing, why you thought of doing CSSP? Like most of us know it's a industry certification, but what all you studied and how was your exam experience? So we will like to hear it from you.
Great. I'll do that. So first of all, am I audible?
Yes, very much.
Okay, great. So thank you, Gaurav. Thank you for having me here today. And thank you, Rajiv sir, too. The previous session was amazing. So to talk about my CISSP journey, it started on the 1st of February and I gave my exam on the 25th of May. So it was basically around four months of rigorous preparation there. And to answer your question on why I decided to do my CISSP, that's a very good question. So I was confused between CISA and CISSP. So when I was looking for studying ahead, I was confused between CISA and CISSP. So what I understood about CISSP was, CISSP, as everybody says, it's a mile wide and an inch deep. So there's almost all areas of security which is being covered in CISSP, all the best practices, technicality-wise, which is being covered in CISSP, in adequate depth. So post doing my CISSP, the difference which I feel in my career is tremendous, not just certification wise, but CISSP is basically a best practice exam. So there is a lot of information which I got through my learnings in CISSP, which I'm being able to apply in my work now. So CISSP, I think, is one of the best decisions I took till date career wise. So that's why my CISSP, I decided to do a CISSP. And then, so as I said, it was 4 months of preparation for me. So it started from February and I gave my exam on 24th of May. So when I say February is a date when I actually sat down with my books and started studying. So even prior to that, I had spent around 15 to 30 days doing my research on CISSP. So when I did my CISSP, I did not personally know anybody who was a CISSP. So all my research was through Google. As in, I had made a list of books that I would need to refer to, the websites which I would need to refer to. So I had spent around 15 days doing my planning there only. And I had taken out my planner. I had charted out what I would be studying on a particular day. So I had made a suitable plan for the next 2 to 3 months. So I know it sounds a little rigorous for everyone, but I feel that planning phase is very important because it saved me a lot of time. Because as and when you start studying later on, there are a lot of distractions that come work-wise, family-wise, or everything. So I feel having a plan that how are you going to go about it is very important when you're preparing for any exam, not just CISSP. So I had done my basic research on what books and what websites to study and everything. So one book which I followed, which helped me 90% of my study, was a Cyvex CISSP official study guide, the 8th edition. So that covered around 90% of my requirements. As in, I can say around 90% of my study was from that particular book. I had read it around twice very rigorously, marking, highlighting the important points and everything. And later on, just brushing the important points, highlighted points during my revision session. So that was my main book during the study. So post that, once I was comfort, I had taken around 2 months to complete this book. So February and March entirely, I was sitting with these two books, this one book. So post that, there is a course by CyberArry. So CyberArry is an online website and this course is completely free. So CyberArry is like the YouTube for all these IT certification exams. So there's a course by Kelly Henderson. It is actually a little outdated, but still I would ask you all to take it because It actually has 8 videos and 8 sessions, 8 different domains in CISSP. It's very brief, it's not comprehensive, but still there are important tips and tricks that you would want to learn from that particular video. Like, for example, for me, it is difficult to memorize things. So my most difficult part was during when it comes to encryption algorithms, making a note of what is a block size, what is a key size. So that is very difficult for me to keep that in my mind. I get confused. So there is tips and tricks which are explained in those videos, like how you can, keep those numbers in your mind. And another particular thing was when it comes to network protocols, which protocol belongs to what layer of the OSI stack. So that is again one area which was difficult for me to remember. So they had, these videos had slightly tips and tricks on how to remember things and what could be the testing areas in CISSP. I wouldn't say you should go 100% by it, but in the end, once you're done with 3/4 of your preparation just for revision or keep things in your mind, you can refer to that particular course. And then post that, my studying was over in by mid-April. So February, March, mid-April, I had finished my studying. And the next 1 month, I had dedicated exclusively for practice exams. So when it comes to practice exams, there are 2 books which I followed. So one is a Sean Harris practice exams, and one is Cybex CISSP official practice test. Cybex was a book which helped me the most and which was most relevant to what came in the exam. So I wouldn't say whatever questions were there in the book came in the exam, but still it was similar, as in the difficulty level and the kind of questions which were asked were similar. So Sean Harris was slightly more difficult than what actually came in the exam. So I'd spent around 1 month doing just practice exams, and the practice methodology also, apart from the normal comprehensive practice test that you do. So I had made sure that I get at least 80% in each of these practice exams, and only then I sign up for the exam, because the CISSP pass percentage is 70%. So I had kept around 10% buffer. So only after I ensured that I had 80% in all 6 practice exams, I signed up for the exam. So apart from that, both these books have questions chapter wise. So domain wise, they have questions. So it's important that you get at least 80% in each of the domain individually. Because CISSP, again, even if you get 90% in all domains and 60% in one domain, it's still going to be a fail. So it's important that you have at least 70% as a pass for each domain. So, but for buffer, I kept at least 80% in each of these domains only after ensuring that in both the books I had signed up for the exam, because otherwise, again, it's a very expensive exam. You cannot afford to give it multiple times. So that was basically my studying process. So 2.5 months was studying, 1.5 months was 2.5 months was studying, 1 month was exams. And prior to all this, I had spent around 30 to 15 days doing my research. So I had a proper plan in place, and I feel that planning is very, very important. Otherwise, you will just keep on postponing. If you write from the day when you have decided to do a CISSP, if you don't have a target date in your mind, like suppose you're starting on 1st June, if you don't target to give this exam by 15th of September, and if you don't target to make that plan, then it's very difficult to make it work. Because for people like me who are, easily distracted, it is very difficult to make it work. So once you have a plan, this week I'll be completing this chapter, next week, that continuity, you'll try to maintain it. Even if there are small distractions, you will somehow try to maintain it. So I feel that planning is the first and the most important step. So studying anything is, anybody with an average brain can study, but getting into that discipline and that dedication to study is very important. That was one thing. And then coming to the test. So my test was on the 24th of May. So now, as you all know, it's a computer adaptive test. So it's basically a 3-hour exam.
Before we move to the testing part, so let's clear few concerns or questions I have from audience on here. So I can take away the planning, discipline, and you have done self study.
Training. Yeah, self study.
All self study, but you bought 2-3 books. And how much was the role this 1.5 month last practice questions made? So what you say, the first part was more important, where you spend more time, or the last part where the practicing question. So if you need to give the weightage, which one is the more
right? I would say after planning, then practicing questions is also important, because studying is one thing, but practicing is actually, you're given on your face what is going to, what not what is going to come, what to expect. So most of the questions in CISSP, technically, apart from technically also, it needs your judgment. So if they give you four options, it is very likely that in most questions, two options you can easily rule out. Two options are technically right, but you need to use your decision-making ability to decide which one of those two are going to be best. So unless you practice many similar questions, it is a little difficult for people who are not very experienced. Even for people who are experienced, it's a little difficult to understand which one of those two to pick. So practicing exams is also important. So once you have done adequate amount of practicing, and if you feel some areas, you know, you're lacking, you can always go back to your study material again and revise your sessions and then come back again to the practice. So that is something which I did. Like, you know, networks was difficult for me. Networks is the most difficult part for me. So initially while I was doing the practice, networks was one area where I was scoring only around 70%. So 70% is risky. So because again, it can go one side or the other side. So I came back.
Okay, I think yeah, this is the next question where it was coming, like, you know, yes, network is mainly difficult for most of the batch here as well, what we are having. So is it like, you know, any particular domain you target that I can ignore it and I can, you know, focus on the six or seven domains and one I will go like that, or it's like you prepare for all the eight domains and then went for it?
No, I wouldn't recommend you to do that, because again, this is an exam in which you need to score 70% in each domain individually. Now, when I explained to you about the exam pattern, it's an adaptive test. So depending, the computer is intelligent enough to understand, are you moderately well or are you, you know, not well in a particular domain. So if you choose to ignore networks, there is a high chance that the computer will ask you questions from network and the algorithm will determine that you're not very good in network. So that is again a fail. So I wouldn't recommend you to skip any domain, any topic for that matter. Even if there are few topics in which you're not very comfortable. Like for my case, it was key length and all encryption sizes. At least have a glance on it and at least try to keep it in your mind. I wouldn't suggest you to skip any topic completely, because I feel it's a very high risk to take.
Okay, I think then the things have changed a lot in last 6-7 years. But yeah, so yeah, we would like to hear now how this adaptive test worked and how was your experience with that. Yeah. Next, yeah.
Okay, so basically this is a 3-hour exam. So, and then there are around 100 to 150 questions. So 100 questions everybody will get, and then over and above that, how many questions you receive depends on how you are giving the test. Like for example, at the 100th question, if the computer is able to determine that going forward, even if I ask you 50 questions, there are chances that you will fail in any one of the domain, your exam will stop there and it will be a fail. Or if the computer determines that going forward also this particular person will be doing well in all the eight domains, it will be a pass. So at the 100th question onwards, every question is crucial. Every question, there is going to be a decision-making process on your pass or fail criteria. So how it works is that each question has a different level of different weightage. So it depends on if the question is easy, it has a lower weightage. If it's difficult, it has a higher weightage. And what is that weightage? And what the computer considers easy, what the computer considers difficult, is something which IC Square has not revealed. So what happens is that if you're not in a particular domain, take for asset security, if the computer is asking you easy questions, you are able to answer, then the computer will move up the difficulty level. So even then, if you're able to answer, and if the computer reaches to an algorithm, okay, this person has 70% knowledge in this particular domain, it will stop asking you questions from there. You're considered pass there and it will move on to a different domain. And the same way, if the computer is starting at the difficulty level and if you're not able to answer, it will come down to the easier level. But at the easier level, you will be required to answer more questions to pass. as in difficulty level, because the weightage is more, even if you answer less number of questions, you will be able to meet the computer's criteria. But at the easier level, you will be required to answer more questions. So again, there should be that number of questions remaining up till 150 for the computer to be able to ask you. And so again, also depends. So what the computer considers difficult might be easy for you. What the computer considers easy might be difficult for you. So I would suggest you to not worry much on all that. Just do your part of giving your best in every question after ensuring that you are, at least 80% good in all the topics. So that's it. I don't recommend you to skip any topic or worry too much about, just understand what is the process, but do not worry too much about the questions being easy or difficult. Just give your best in every question which is being put to you.
I must say that was insightful about the exam pattern. So if I directly ask you a question, so how many questions you were given, like 110, 112?
I was actually given, I was given 151 questions, which was surprising because in the website they say they ask only 150 questions. And even I was surprised because at the 100th question, I was expecting it to stop because I was actually confident that I had done 80% well in all domains. But it went up to the 151st question where it stopped and then it gave me a pass message. So
you were saying that after 100th question, every question is a decision maker. So then attempting 51 questions, yes, thinking that I am pass or fail, it's going to be very difficult, right?
It's going to be very difficult. Actually, it was stressful for me because at the 100th question, I was expecting that I'm doing extremely well. So I don't know. So after that, I had taken breaks. So you're allowed to take breaks. But the only thing is the break gets counted in your timer. So not just a break. So every time you leave the exam hall, they take your fingerprint. You come back, they take your fingerprint. There is basic frisking happening. So all that gets included in your exam time. So but then I was taking breaks. I was going out drinking water, relaxing myself and coming back and sitting there.
Okay, amazing.
Yeah, it is a stressful exam.
And here we don't have option to go back, right? If you have answered a question, you have answered it. No option of going back.
No, you don't have an option to go back. And one more thing which I felt personally was that I felt it was slightly psychometric also. As in, I felt, somewhere in the beginning they had asked me a question and I had picked an answer, and somewhere in the 73rd or 75th question, there was a similar question, maybe concept-wise similar, but the options and the question were different. So I felt it was kind of psychometric also. It was trying to test if you're just, marking A, B, C, D by fluke, or if you're actually understanding the concept and then marking something. So that is something which I personally felt. At many places, I felt two or three questions were kind of psychometric. They were repetitive in nature.
Or maybe I must say it, maybe like, they want to try that, when you are fresh enough or you are starting, what's your thought process, or maybe when you are at the end of R and what is the thought process you have or how you are performing in the pressure.
Right.
That also can be one of the factors.
Right. All that was there. It was correct. Yeah.
Yeah, go on.
Yeah, I was just telling it is kind of, trying to assess if you're actually strong in something, or is it just that you're marking something, or are you trying to get out of it by luck? It is actually testing if you are good in the concept.
Okay. I mean, it seems looking like, quite interesting, and it's I am feeling like going back again to, write the exam instead of maintaining my CPs. I'll write once again. So...
it's an interesting exam, I must say, but many people, one mistake I did was 2-3 days before writing the exam, I was googling on CISSP results and I saw a lot of negative reviews. So I would suggest all of you please not to do that, because there's a lot of negativity on the internet, and then which actually made me a little down. But once I was doing the exam, I did not feel it was something unachievable. Even for somebody who's, not that experienced, I did not feel it is something unachievable. It is absolutely doable, provided you have put in hard work and provided you have that dedication, concept is clear. I feel it's just like any other exam. Maybe the pattern is different or something, but once you've done your part, there is nothing much to worry in that exam. There's nothing much to think that, okay, this is very difficult, it's undoable. There's nothing like that.
Sure, Krishnan, that's really insightful. I think we have a few questions. So guys, what I will do is I'll open up the chat as well as I'll open up, you can raise your hand. Maybe we can take 3-4 questions. So we have Kahoot for 15 minutes. So 12:15 we will have quiz. So I'll give you 9 minutes with Krishna to, ask if you have any specific thing you wanted to ask. You can feel free to raise your hand. Okay. I see the first hand from Dr. Murgun. Okay, unmuting you.
Guru, this good morning. Is the question for Krishna or Rajiv?
Krishna. Oh, you raised previously?
Yeah.
Okay. I think, so all who have raised previously can lower your hand. I'll unmute who has question for Krishna. Maybe I don't know Virendra. Okay, going next to you.
Am I audible?
Yes, Virendra, you are.
Yeah, hi. Good afternoon. Krishna, first of all, congratulations.
Hi, thank you so much.
I have some basic fundamental questions. Is it that you need to go to the Promatic Center or you can do it online at home?
No, you need to go to the Pearson Test Center. And it's pretty strict, actually. There at the test center, there is frisking. They take your thumb impression and everything. You can ask for, the test center is very good. You can even ask for noise-canceling earphones and everything. But you cannot do the test at home. You will have to go to the test center where you are recorded on the webcam also.
And what is allowed along with you? Can you take water bottle?
No, actually nothing is allowed, not even a pen. So they give you the paper, rough work paper and pen. So water is there outside. If you want, you can take water breaks, washroom breaks are allowed. But as I said, the moment you go outside, you cannot stop the clock and go. So the clock keeps ticking. So, and even if you go out for water and come, again, there is the thumb impression taking process. So that will take some 10-20 seconds. So all that time will get counted in your exam time. You're not allowed to take water bottles inside.
Oh, okay. Another thing what I wanted to check is that now I understand there are 8 domains in your minimum 17, right?
Yes.
Now,
yes.
Is it the complexity increases domain by domain, or it is like every domain is like starting from maybe say simple, then become a little bit more hard and then harder?
So what I understood was every domain starts at the simple level. And then as you progress, it increases the difficulty level. So in one particular domain, if you are able to answer the difficult questions, it will take you a less number of questions to answer to reach the pass criteria. But as in another domain, as it's increasing the difficulty, suppose you're not able to answer, it will come back to the simpler level. But there you will be required to answer more simple questions to reach the pass in that particular domain.
So basically what you are saying is, what I understand, correct me if I'm wrong, is that as we start answering the question, depending upon how you respond to those questions or answer those questions, the complexity may increase or may get lower down, right?
Right.
And it is across all the 8 domains. It's not necessarily, domain by domain.
No. It's independent for all 8 domains. Actually, you should be treating each domain as an individual exam is what I feel. Because again, there is no overlapping between these domains. Each domain, the pass criteria is also 80% each. So you should be treated each as an individual exam.
Right. Thanks, Krishna. Thanks. And one more thing. Practice exam, which one? Harris, and what was the other one?
Sean Harris and then Cybex. Cybex is very useful, is what I felt. Cybex was more useful to me than Sean Harris, because Sean Harris is slightly outdated. And the kind of questions which I saw in Sean Harris and the kind which I saw in the exam were not very similar. So Cybex CISSP was more similar.
Oh, okay. So basically you are recommending Cybex, right?
Yeah, Cybex. Both for studies and for practice exam, I feel Cybex was the best.
That is the IC Square standard?
Yeah. It's an IC Square standard book. So IC Square also has a CBK. CBK is more comprehensive. So CBK, I had just referred for light reading. All my study was on Cybex only.
On that, to add, Virendra, and for everyone, during this training, we have mostly covered CBK. So I will prefer now, if you have done this training, go ahead and read Cybex in detail.
Thanks, Krishna Lord here.
Yeah, welcome. No problem.
Okay, Akash.
Hi, Krishna. This is Akash.
Hi, Akash.
I have a couple of questions. Very weird, but just curious to know about, because I'm just starting my CSSP training.
Okay.
As you are doing. And
yeah.
Let me take a Gaurav support for our online training and that. Let's see. So the first question is like random answer. Now you said that when it is dependent on the questions to question, like you are giving the one by one. It is like
right.
Normally what we do, that first question is given and we are going, okay, this is the second one is hard, third one is, I'll give the later one, let's go with the next one. Can we do that?
I did not get your question.
Okay, like how the test normally giving the objective questions or something, like you have three and first answer you are giving, okay, fine. Second, I'm not okay. Third one is a little bit hard. I'll go with the fourth one or something like that.
So you don't have that option, right? I hope you got the question, Krishna.
Yeah. So are you asking me, correct me if I'm wrong, are you asking, can you choose to skip and then go to the next question?
Correct. And later on you will come back and you will put the answer again.
No, that's not possible. You cannot come back to a question. You cannot skip or mark for review and come back. So one question at a time, you need to answer it. And you cannot leave a question blank also. I forgot to mention that. You need to answer something. And if there is a negative marking or not, is something which IIC Square has not revealed.
Okay.
So you will be required to answer every question, and you cannot choose to come back to a question later, even if you have not answered or marked for review. Unless you press an option, the next button will not be enabled.
Oh, okay. My second question is, like, you know, are you aware of this lab test or some modular or something they are giving? What is you say? How you, when you are giving the CC, I gave the CCNA. So they are giving a test exam, a lab test or something. Do we have like that?
So there are, I think there are IIC Square test bundles which you can purchase. And there are test bundles by other organizations also, which I have not purchased. So I don't know much about it. I felt this book was more than sufficient for my preparation.
No. My question is, what is called, Gaurav, that...
Yeah, I got that, but I think for CSSP there is no lab requirement, Akash.
Oh, okay, no lab. Okay, yep. Actually, Krishna, where you are located as of now?
I'm working out of Mumbai only, but due to the current situation, I have moved to Cochin, which is my hometown.
Okay, and then Bangalore, any public center you want to recommend, or do you have any idea?
I think that option is all available on the website. While you are registering for the exam, they will give you the option addresses as well as the available dates.
Okay. And what about the fees structure? Is there or something when you are being a member of some group or something? Is there anything or is there some?
Yeah. Actually, the exam fee was around $825, so which came to around 60,000 INR. And then apart from that, there's a membership fee, yearly membership fee, which is $125.
Okay. My question. Thank you. Thank you, Krishna.
Yeah, welcome.
Vidyadhar, go ahead.
Thanks, Gaurav. Congratulations, Krishna.
Thank you so much.
And my question is, how did you manage the time in the 150 questions? Was it per question or you considered yourself 10 question lot and all?
No, actually, I didn't have a big issue with time management because I felt there was sufficient time. As in, even I had taken after my 100th question, I was a little stressed out. So I had taken 2-3 breaks. Even then, I felt there was sufficient time. As in per question, I think I had taken around 30 seconds. For easier questions, lesser maybe. In for something, as soon as I see if I was sure, if it was a direct concept question, there were a few direct concept questions. So in that, twice I had read and I had given it immediately. But in some questions like match the following, there were a few match the following questions for which I took time.
Okay. And there were any drag down items also?
Yeah, there were a few match the following. So in that, I think they were drop down kind of things.
Okay. Thanks, Krishna. I'm done. Thank you.
Okay.
So Krishna, you can let me know when you are done. Okay. I think I can see 7-8 more hands, but I can allocate 2-3 more questions. Okay for you? Tushar, yeah.
Yeah, hi Krishna.
Hi.
Yeah, so my question is about specifically when you you have dedicatedly prepared for the exam, but when it comes to the working professional, what daily time period you recommend to have put in to
so actually
exam in 6 months?
Yeah, I had given myself around only 1 hour on weekdays and 6 to 7 hours on weekends. And public holidays also 6 to 7 hours. And then I, as I told you, I had a plan. So if I was not able to meet that plan on certain weeks, I used to try to squeeze in some time even on weekdays. Or if I could call in, you know, take a half day at work when there was not much workload. So I used to take some time on weekdays also. But as a practice, I had taken 1 hour on weekdays and 5 to 6 hours on weekends.
Okay. My second question is, when it comes to exam, so the 3 hours is a completely time period for 150 question, or do we have specific timer for individual question?
No. If complete 150 questions, you have 3 hours.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
So, and just one more thing I would like to mention. So this is again one mistake which I did. So during my free time, I used to browse on Google, you know, sample CISSP questions, which all of us do. And there are numerous sites which pops up. So one thing is, you know, just don't go into some site and answer the question and get the wrong answer key. So there are a lot of misleading sites on Google and they give you the wrong answer. So you end up learning the wrong thing. So that is very dangerous. So that is something which I realized late, that many of these sites on Google, so unless it's extremely reliable, I wouldn't recommend you to just type sample CISSP questions and answer from any site.
This one is really a good one, Krishna. I think many people generally do and try to attempt those questions. And also I have observed, you know, few training centers, like, you know, you try to attempt their questions over there. Even if you are right, they will tell you wrong and they will ask you, you know, come and join our training. So those kind of things are also happening online. So that's a valid point, and I think we never discussed about this. But yeah, thank you. Okay, Mahesh.
Hello.
Yeah, hello. Yes, tell me.
So first of all, congratulations to you.
Thank you.
You have only 4 years experience and you have achieved a milestone. This is very wonderful thing I have ever seen in my life. And
Thank you so much.
Second thing that you have talking about the CISP versus the season. So suppose professional, suppose we have experience of 10 years. So we would like to go for the CISM examinations or CISP, because CISP is more technical terms for future growth. And if you're talking about the CISM, so it's more about, you know, what management sort of things. So which is better? And if I'm going for the CISP examination, so what is the future prospects for CISM versus CISP?
So again, that depends on what is your requirement. So for me, what it was like, I wanted to increase my technical knowledge first and then go into what is decision, more of decision making and managerial. So that is why I first focused on CISSP, and CISM or CISA I'll take up later. So that again, so the prospects of CISSP is very good, as in it is one of the most respected certificates, I would say. And not just that, the difference it has brought in my profession is also very high. So if you now, if I could compare myself a four-year experienced person and with a CISSP knowledge, the kind of decisions that I am able to make and the kind of practices that I'm able to contribute to my organization is higher. Like, as in, there might be something in my organization which is done in a particular way, but once you do CISP and once you do prepare for CISP, you understand that that is not the right way to do. There's a best practice, it's something else which can be done, so which I'm able to suggest to my organization now. So that is there. But CISP versus CISM, I don't think I'll be able to give an answer. So that again depends on the requirement.
I can add on that. So yeah, CISSP and CISM, I have both. So I have experienced both the exams. So Mahesh, so for everyone as well, like, CISSP is more on technical nature. Like, if you are working as a part of team and you have given a responsibility, you know, to perform a particular task in the technical fashion, you can do that. CISSP comes as with the experience of managing a team of CISSP, I can say. or a technical team. It's more from the project management front as well. So it's not that technical, but it's like how you can handle information security projects end to end and having a team to work for that. But CSSP is the team itself. So it's more of an individual contributor or technical role. Yeah.
So it's about, you know what, if I'm talking about a CTO or CISO, so CSP is a better choice for the thing.
CISO or CSP, they need to have CSSP, maybe early stage, and they should have done CSSP and work for 3-4 years on that those particular topic before going to that. Maybe, yeah, that's a different debate or something. Maybe let's stick to the CSSP exam related questions. So Naresh, yeah, moving to you.
Thanks
Mahesh. Yeah.
Thanks, Gaurav, and congratulations, Krishna. But my question, asked by other, so it's more of working professionals. How do we manage our time? And you did give that answer on a weekday. How much we spend, how much we spend. But how do we maintain this, dedication and the constant practice and the learning? I know it depends on the individual, but. Do you want to add on that?
Yeah, so that's why I mentioned the importance of planning. So me, myself, I'm somebody who requires to be motivated continuously. So that's why even before preparing, I had charted out on my planner on what day, what unit I'll be covering specifically from which book. So as in once it starts, every day morning you get up and you know what to do on that particular day, it falls into place automatically is what I felt. So even on certain days, if I'm just not able to finish my goal due to work or family requirements or something, I was able to, at least I had an idea what to do next. So once I got into the flow and that fire was in my belly and I had a proper plan in place, it all fell into place automatically. So that's why I was stressing planning is very important, because midway it is very easy for us to get distracted or give up.
Yeah. Thank you so much for your, ideas.
Yeah,
thanks, Naresh. And I think last two questions, Krishna, for you. Sneha, yeah. Sneha, I'm trying to unmute you. Okay, Narendra, you can go ahead.
Am I audible? Hello.
Yes, you are. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Hi, Krishna. So first of all, many congratulations for clearing the CSSP. That's a milestone
thank
for you.
Much.
Yeah. And and thank you for the insightful journey that you provided. I think you answered most of the questions. Just a quick question, which I think you just mentioned about the cyber, some particular course that you were trying to refer maybe after 75%, 80% of your studies. So what is that particular course? If you can just provide that detail.
Yeah. So there is a website called CyberArry. So once you go into it and if you search for CISSP courses, CISSP material, there is a course by Kelly Anderson. So there are, I think, around 8 videos, one focusing on each domain. So this is not very comprehensive. It is just basics. But what I felt useful from that was there were many takeaways on tips and tricks on how to remember certain things. That is why I felt you should cover it only after 75 or 80% of your studies, just to remember a few things which you might tend to forget.
Okay. Yeah, thank you, Krishna. I just wanted that name, Kelly Anderson, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much. And wish you all the best.
Yeah. Thank you. Wish you the same too.
Hi, Krishna.
Hi.
It's more from a perspective like if you are not working in information security, how important is experience you give? Do you think experience is important when you're giving this exam? So, for example, I have more than 10 years of experience, but I have worked in information security auditing in the beginning, but then I moved on in my career into something else. So coming back into information security is now something new for me as things have changed. So if someone is more like a fresher or something, how would you advise him? Like, would you advise like just learning and from the book is good enough, or practical experience also matters like a lot if you want to clear this exam? Just thought I'll ask your inputs on that.
Okay. I felt at least, bookish content you can learn and give, you might pass also, but I felt at least one and a half years of experience will give you a better understanding of the concepts that you're learning. As in, when it comes to, you will be able to relate to things which you're learning, so that will happen at least after one and a half years of experience. So that does not mean a fresher cannot give an exam. He can give it, he can pass also with dedication, but I felt at least one and a half years of experience would be more useful.
Okay, so when you're working in it, that's where you can relate more than being a pure theoretical person, right?
Right. You'll be able to relate to things which you're dealing with in everyday scenario. So you'll be able to apply things better is what I felt.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Okay, I think we are done. Sneha, I think I can see you right now. Anything you want to add now? Sneha, we can't hear you. Okay, Karupa Sami. So yeah, that's the last question.
Hi Krishna, one question. Have you referred CSSP Cybert US or Indian version?
I think it is the one which is for sale in the Indian subcontinent.
Okay. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
Okay, and that's a really helpful and insightful, Krishna. And
thank you so much.
Thanks for accepting this at a very short notice. I know.
No issue. My pleasure.
Thanks a lot. So, guys, if you have any other questions, I will try to get those answered. But right now, I think it's a time we should move to our section. So, Krishna, I'd like you to stay and play Kahoot quiz with us for next 15 minutes and. You can give us a rating that how it will, if like, look like an actual exam or not.
Yeah.